Today's podcast is brought to you by WarbyParker.com. Get a free 5-day home try-on at WarbyParkerTrial.com/David Feldman Show. 5 pairs, 5 days, 100% free.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the David Feldman program. I am not David Feldman. I am Kevin Bartini, sitting in for our buddy David, who could not be here today. But we have a great episode for you. We have David Proval, a legendary character actor. You guys know him from Mean Streets. You know him from The Sopranos. You know him from just about every TV show and quality movie that's come out over the last 40 years.
Yeah.
This is he's a phenomenal actor. And my buddy Adam Lash and I are lucky enough to be able to sit down and do a phone interview with him. Now, you can hear you'll be able to hear this interview or parts of it right now, and then you can hear the entire interview at Movie Preview Review, which is our normal podcast. It's also on the Showbiz Network, and Adam and I co-host with a couple of other people. And the premise of our show is that we review movies based on only watching their previews. So we're going to talk to Mr. Proval about making movies and about television and about The Sopranos and about whatever else he's interested in talking to us. And then on the Movie Preview Review, we will also have a segment where we actually watch a couple of movie previews of David Proval movies and review them. So this is the David Feldman Show. Again, I'm Kevin Bartini with Adam Lash, and we are here because David is on assignment and because Liam McNeeney has moved away. So they got me to host this show. Anyway, all right, so we'll be back in just a moment after a couple of breaks, and you will hear us talk to Mr. David Proval. Okay, everybody, well, it is time to get down to our interview. We are very lucky. I'm a little nervous here. I'm a big fan of this man and so much of his work, but we are on the phone with the great Mr. David Proval. You guys know him from so many wonderful movies, films, plays. He is a consummate actor, a consummate professional, and someone who, as soon as you see his face, you're like, oh my God, I love that guy, and I've seen him in everything. He is currently, you can see him in The Brooklyn Banker, which is a film that Adam and I both enjoyed, and we've spoken of on our podcast before. So would like to give a warm welcome to Mr. David Proval. Thank you so much for being on our show, sir.
Okay, my pleasure, guys. My pleasure.
So I thought we would start with just a chat a little bit about The Brooklyn Banker, because we have seen it and we enjoyed it. And if you can give us a little, you know, a little background on how you came to that picture, and we can go from there.
The picture came into my life through my agent and his script. Mm-hmm. And I was on my way to Hawaii with my wife and my daughter and my mother-in-law, and took the script with me. My wife warned me. She said, don't take any screenplays with you. We're on holiday. But I took this one with me. And on the plane, I read, and by the time I got to Hawaii, I needed to get Michael Rossigliano Jr. or whomever wrote this on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought it was just beautifully written, and its authenticity in the writing is what attracted me. It was so authentic. I could easily visualize characters, and it's just specific, and actors, food. It was very rich.
It takes place in Brooklyn in a time where you grew up in Brooklyn around that time as well. Am I correct in that assumption?
Oh, I grew up in Brooklyn a couple of years before that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And I knew Williamsburg. I lived two neighborhoods away from Williamsburg, or three neighborhoods away. But, you know, Brooklyn is Brooklyn. And today it's become the Paris of, you know, the East Coast. Brooklyn is now very popular.
Yeah.
Amazing.
It is, it's amazing to see how much it's changed just in the 15 years since I've lived here in New York City to see Brooklyn. So did you also do the short film that this was also started as, or did you come on later?
No, not much later.
You came on much later.
Yeah, they did the short film. They got a lot of awards for the short film. Mm-hmm. I heard that it entered into film festivals. It was, great actors. Well, Paul Savino was in a short film, uh-huh, as well as the feature film.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And Tony Leung, great cast in the short film, mm-hmm, as well. And Federico directed the short film. It won a lot of awards. It did well.
It did very well. And as well, you also teamed up with some of these guys for Queen for a Day, which was a play that you did off Broadway, which was also recently on a project, correct?
That's right.
That's right.
The possibility of a film.
Really?
That's what Michael's talking about. Yeah.
Oh, very cool.
Maybe we'll see. See what happens.
Well, that would be great.
Yeah, it was off Broadway, and the audience response for the play was enormous, and Michael, he garnered some great notices, Michael Siciliano, on the play, and it was great to do. It was great. The audience responses were amazing.
Yeah.
People loved the play, you know, edge of the seat kind of thing. They were sitting and screaming. Oh, it's fantastic.
Now you seem to be an actor who you don't think of as like is just a movie star. Like, you're a guy who bounces from one thing to the next, movies to theater and television. And is that something that is important for you, to keep a balance, to do the different things?
No, what's important is that, theater and film are two different. For the actor, it's just apples and oranges. Mm-hmm. It's an amazingly different experience doing film and the part of your instrument you use. And, when you get on stage for 2 hours, there's no, let's start that over and do another take. You're on the edge all the time.
Right.
I mean, people, it's happened. You know, guys go up on stage and the audience knows it and they love it. But to most part, for 90 minutes or however long the play runs, you got to be there. Mm-hmm. And there's no stopping, and there's no, you're using, parts of you and the commitment, a very different kind of experience in a film where you know, okay, if I mess up right now, and the director will say, ho, let's do it better than this, and you got another take.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that it's an easier thing. Film acting and theater acting are both they're in par with each other. They're not, one is not easier than the other.
Right.
And film is not easier. It's not that it's easier. You know, it's a whole other thing. That's all. But it's nice to know that I can do it again right now. Again on stage, you know.
Is there one that you prefer to the other?
Depends on the material. You know, there are plays that are just meant to do on stage. And when you attempt to film them or tape them, they lose their power. Mm. And there are plays that translate very easily to film, and they're wonderful. But it always depends on the material. I mean, the character offers you a challenge, and it's theater, whatever it is, whether it be theater, television, or film. It's my measure. If the character offers the challenge, and it's, at this point in my life, I'd like to do something that's important. Like after November 8th, when we can breathe again after the election. I can't breathe right now, man. I'm not breathing right now. I don't know where you are. I mean, as far as what your choices are, and I'm taking a chance right now, guys. But I can't wait until Hollywood gets on. How many television shows and how many films are there going to be on this political race?
Oh, yeah.
Well, if I can get something in those movies and those plays, mm-hmm, and if it's, their heart's in the right place, I can't wait. I mean, it's stuff like that, you know, that, once we're going to do it. Yeah, I'd love to be.
Yeah.
Does that make any sense to you?
Sure,
you
know what absolutely.
I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, right, right.
Wanting to do something vital and, you know, yeah, you can already sense that, you know, HBO is working on some idea of a post-election thing. And
there's thousands of stories behind the main story right now that people want and need to know about.
Right.
Yeah.
It's pretty
sure.
insane.
You
were just, I mean, we've been over the last couple of days just going through your IMDb and things and just such great memories of different things of movies and different things that we've watched over the years and have loved.
Yeah.
And we had a couple of questions about a couple of things you've been a part of. My favorite movie of all time is certainly in my top three is The Shawshank Redemption. And what a wonderful film. And I enjoyed you in that. And it was one of those movies that seems to have grown in popularity over the years. And I was just wondering if you had any recollections or stories of that movie and that experience, because it's such a wonderful film.
Shawshank... You know, it was based on a short story, you know,
right.
a Stephen
yep.
King's
yep.
short stories. Okay.
Right.
And I read the short story they sent me, and I loved that a lot, the short story. It was very un-Kingy. I mean, it was it's a drama. It's not, horror thing.
Right.
And then the screenplay, when they, what they did with the screenplay, I thought was fantastic. And, you know, it's great to be part of a movie that, across the board has had audience appeal. People love that movie. It's now one of the 10 best films, American films ever. Mm-hmm. It's voted one of the 10 best American films ever right now. I think it's on the list. It's great to be part of all that.
Sure.
I've been lucky enough to be, you know, asked to do it. But I'm going to be completely honest with you guys.
Uh-huh.
As me and four other character actors, what we were hoping for is to flush out more of an ensemble. Great movie, and Morgan Freeman and Tim Robbins, and it's a love story between two men, and it worked the way it was. But I'm going to be honest about this.
Mm-hmm.
We sat, and I always felt that if they had flushed out the ensemble,
mm-hmm.
and each guy had his moment, mm-hmm. Each character, I would have been a happier camper.
Yeah.
So here I am in one of the films that everybody loves, and I'm going to tell you, I had a frustrating experience on it.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't what I thought it would be, what I was promised it would be. But, hey, that's all selfish on my part. That's all, it's just selfish. It's a selfish act of boohooing sour grapes boohoo. But that's honest. I'm being straight talking with you.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you the truth. And I wasn't alone with that. There were other actors who, wonderful actors who cast in that, who were saying, when are we going to shoot this? And they never got around to it. But,
right. Yeah, it wasn't.
Yeah.
It was,
anyway, that's. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, just to keep on the theme of being amongst some of the a part of one of the 10 greatest films of all time, you're also a part of what are considered two of the greatest TV series of all time. You had one episode of The West Wing, and you, of course, are with The Sopranos. So,
yeah.
Sopranos.
You know, that's always considered in the top three, and West Wing somewhere in the top five. I mean,
And then
not to mention Everybody Loves Raymond as well. It's like one of the greatest sitcoms of all times. You really found your way in some of the greatest things ever.
Right.
It's wonderful.
No, I went from, years ago, I went from Richie to Pearl to playing a rabbi.
Right.
Yeah.
I went from Richie to rabbi. And then Everybody Loves Raymond, which is the number one comedy. I went from the number one drama to the number one comedy.
Right.
Very lucky. I went two number one shows.
Two.
Comedy to drama.
Was there at the time a conscious effort after Richie Aprile to do, you know, to do something so different with the West Wing and then with Raymond to not end up just being in mobster stuff for the rest of your career, to break away from that and to do a rabbi and to do...
When the agent called
like
me
that.
And said there's a role for a rabbi on West Wing, I said, get me. And she said, well, you just, Richie Aprile, you're not going to get it.
Yeah.
I said, get me in. Just get me in the office. She said, but they're Richie, you know. And I said, look, just get me in. Mm-hmm. And yeah, then she got me in and I got the gig. Yeah.
That's right.
I had to audition because the director, it was Tommy Salami, one of those guys who directed the show, had not seen Sopranos.
Really?
He hadn't seen the show, which was lucky for me, because I'm working and doing the rabbi on the set, he finally saw the show. He said, if I had seen that show, I would never had a meeting with you. that's the most flattering thing I've ever heard.
Sure. And
I thank you.
Yeah. And you can't help but, you know, if you just combine those two ideas of just thinking of Rabbi Glassman, just, you know, whispering to Richie Aprile that, you know, murder is not Jewish.
right. And I was at a Dodger game, and someone turned around, and they said, wait a second, you were the rabbi. And the guy next to him said, no, that's Richie Aprile. It was fantastic at a Dodger game. Two guys arguing about what role I did. It was amazing. It was such fun.
Sure.
Yeah, that was fun.
That actually leads to a question of what do you most often find yourself recognized as? Like when people come up to you in the airport or something, is it still Richie Aprile?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot of Richie, and it's a lot of mean streets too.
Yeah, absolutely.
When I'm in New York, it's a lot of mean streets. People love that movie.
Yeah.
You know, it's Mean Streets is a great, great film. And it's a lot of Mean Streets, but mostly Sopranos, of course.
Right.
Mostly Sopranos. You go, Richie, I have that when I'm in New York. When you're in L.A., everybody's a movie star in L.A. You know, they're all gorgeous and they're all movie stars.
Mm-hmm.
And I live out of L.A. I'm an hour out of L.A. I can't live in L.A.
Yeah.
But I'm at the beach and people... here are people. But if you go into LA, everybody's a movie star or somebody's got a script. So everybody's so cool. You know, nobody says anything to anybody. they're just kind of walking around with hand mirrors looking at themselves, you know. It's just these guys are doing it. Yeah. So nobody says anything in LA. It's very funny.
Yeah.
Very strange.
Yeah, they're pretending that they don't recognize you, but you know, they're just doing their best to hide that that's Richie Aprile over there.
Exactly. Right. For the New Yorker, you see a New Yorker, they don't care. New Yorker just comes to your face. Hey, I love you. What are you doing? Hey, how are you? You know, and I love that.
Right.
I'm a Brooklyn kid. They just come up to you and say, you were great on our show. Well, what are you making a living? Yeah, I'm doing all right. God bless you. And they walk away. New Yorkers, I've always been the best that way. And there's no, like, look at me. Mm-hmm. And that's wonderful that way.
Yeah.
Here, it's exactly what you just said.
Right.
I'm going to pretend I don't know anything. Yeah, exactly. And you can see them pretending. You're going to like, sort of look over every once in a while just to check if you're fat or...
Yeah. Well, the flip side of that coin is the New Yorkers will also let you know if you sucked in something, right? They won't hide that either.
If they didn't like you on the show,
mm-hmm.
Oh, geez, they let you know.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. What'd you do that piece of crap for? I saw you the other night. A guy came up to me one day. He was the greatest in New York, and I did a show. And you do. I've done a lot of shows. You've Googled me, so you know how many I've done.
Oh, sure.
102 or something like that.
Yeah.
And sometimes they're conquered, and you do something bad, and mm-hmm. this happens. You know, you got to make a living. And guys come up in New York and say, What kind of piece of crap did you do the other night? I was sitting around. I couldn't believe you did that. I said, yeah, I'm sorry. I always apologize for it. I said, but I needed the money. I tell him the truth. I said, I just need the bucks. You know?
but then even, I'm also like, even the fact that you were playing Richie Aprile, who was the antagonist to Tony for a full season, were people getting pissed at you for the things Richie was doing or things that he did to Janice or to other people? Were people actually like, oh, how dare you? Like that? Did you have some of that as well?
I've had a couple experiences at airports usually where I'm trying to get on a plane one day and a guy in a running suit, he looked like one of those guys, you know, tough guy, you know, no neck, you know, one of no neck guys. He comes over to me and he says to me, how you doing? I said, no, I'm okay, thank you. He says, say hello to Angelo. I said, who? He said, Angelo. I said, I'm sorry, I don't know who you're talking about. He says, oh, I got you. You don't want to say anything. I said, what? I said, oh, you know, it's like I'm inside, like one of the guys. And then I said, no, I do not know Angelo. Said, okay, take a picture with my wife. And I said, gee, I got to get on the plane. The plane is leaving. I have no time. And I've had experiences with guys who kind of got confused about realities, and they did.
Yeah.
And they say, yeah, they do. They do. They get like, no, you can tell other people who you are. I know who you are. It gets strange. It got strange for a while. It did. It did.
People think it's a documentary more in their head than.
Well, people think you know, I know who you are. You can fool other people, but I know you from the streets.
Yeah.
Well, I'm a big sissy actress, and I'm the biggest cream puff in the world. You know, and excuse me, but I did graduate college. I'm sorry about that. The real college. I mean, I didn't go to Waiter College. Uh-huh. You know, right. Real college. I did graduate. I'm sorry. I'm really just pretending. You know, you got to tell them, or else it gets very strange.
Yeah.
It gets very strange. They confuse realities, you know, and but I haven't had that with a rabbi. No. I've not had rabbis come up to me and say, hey, I love what you think. God bless you. And Happy New Year. You know,
Shalom.
Yeah, somebody's hit me with a shalom. Yeah. No.
Mazel, all right.
Now, another of maybe not considered one of the 10 greatest films of all time, but 10 favorite films of my own childhood is UHF.
Yes.
And we are huge fans of Weird Al and of that movie. And what a what a strange movie it was back then, but how much we loved it. And if memory serves, it's been a while since I've seen it, but you ended up getting the face full of staples in that movie, right?
That's right.
That was you. Right. I told them.
Good job, Kevin.
Dude, what do you remember of that movie? And do you get recognized still from that because of the cult like status that
Weird Al has? Let me tell you something. How often guys come up to me and say, you're in one of my favorite movies, and I'm ready to say, yeah, Shawshank is a great movie, and they say UHF.
Right?
It happens really, and usually in college towns, kids come up because it's got a great following, that movie.
Yeah.
It really has an enormous following. People love it.
It really
and
was
what
fun.
I remember about that movie mostly is that Weird Al Yankovic, who's genuinely a weird guy.
Yeah.
He didn't have that problem on narcolepsy or whatever that thing is when people fall asleep.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He could do it though. He could make himself fall asleep in the middle of lunch.
Really?
And what I remember about that movie, you would sit there and suddenly you'd be sleeping. And at first it's, oh Jesus, this guy got that. He says, no, he can just do that. Huh. The guy was able to fall asleep with a piece of meat in his mouth. I mean, I really liked him a lot.
Yeah.
And his girlfriend was there. What I remember about that movie is we shot it in Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. The heat was about 110 every day. Mm-hmm. We were near Oral Roberts University. So some of the kids that worked on the movie were students at Oral Roberts. Uh-huh. And I don't know, they all wanted to turn the cast into Bible reading, and you're dealing with Hollywood guys. I mean, you know, the godless creatures you're dealing with. And these kids would come on the set and say, David, I want you to read this part of the Bible today. And I said, listen, it's really hot right now. I can't read. That's what I remember about that movie. It was a very strange shoot.
Were you surprised at the success that UHSF had when it came out?
Shocked.
Yeah.
Really shocked. I could not. Yeah, I never thought that was going to go anywhere. And working with Kevin McCarthy, he was a great actor. Mm-hmm. Great actor. And Billy Barty, you know, the man.
Sure.
Yeah, and I used to hang out with those guys after shoot, and that was great. I loved that.
And
old Hollywood stories they would tell me, you know, that was great.
Yeah.
It was great.
And you had Michael Richards as well, right as Seinfeld was just starting. He was in that movie. Pre-Kramer.
Yeah.
I think that was the first thing
Kramer,
I'd seen.
Kramer, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because
this came out in 1989 and Seinfeld came out just about the same time.
Yeah,
pretty simultaneous. There's a couple of movies and projects that you've done that my co-host Adam is particularly interested in, so I wanted to turn it over to him for a second.
Thanks. So, David, I was also searching through the old IMDb today, and I saw that you were in The Phantom, which was the Hollywood's attempt to try to start the comic book movie craze in the mid-90s. So I was wondering, like, because that was, like, one of the first comic book movies that people were making, like, after Batman's success. So I was wondering, like, what was it like being in one of the first comic book films, and, like, did you ever think that comic book movies would become so popular as they have today?
No, and I didn't understand why Phantom didn't get what it deserved, because I think it's a beautiful movie, and I thought Billy Zane was fantastic. I loved him. Catherine Zeta, she's always great. And Phantom... And I didn't understand why that movie is such a beautifully shot movie.
Yeah.
And for me, it was a three-continent movie.
Wow.
We shot in Thailand. We shot in Australia. We shot here in L.A. It was one of those great jobs where you travel and stay at the best hotels in the world. You know, I mean, it was a great job from that aspect.
Cool.
And you get to hang out with Catherine Zeta every once in a while. You know, that was fun.
Yeah.
She's such a beauty. She's a beauty. And she's a great person. And the director, oh Jesus, his name, you got it in front of you? I lost it.
The director of Phantom.
Yeah, Kevin, you got that?
I can look it up real fast.
Oh, I forgot it. Anyway, really a fine director. Really, visually, I mean, shot incredible. And editing, I don't know how well. It didn't do that well. As well as the Batman and the other. That was disappointing. I really thought those guys were going to nail it, and it was going to be a big box office hit, which it wasn't. I don't think it was. I may be wrong. I hope I'm,
It was directed by Simon Winsor. Is that how you say his name?
Simon Winsor. Yes, of course.
Yeah.
Great guy. Great guy. Really nice guy. Australian or a Brit? Now I don't remember. But really very, very good guy. And it was his shot. You know, it was a big movie and it was his shot, you know.
He was born in Sydney, Australia.
Oh yeah, Australia. And Aussie, yeah.
And the other movies you would know his work for was Quigley Down Under with Tom Selleck, I believe, and most famously Free Willy.
Oh wow!
So he was either director or assistant director on Free Willy. So and looks like
really fine director.
Yeah, and then you had another question, Adam, about something else you loved that David has done.
You were on one of my favorite shows as a kid, A Quantum Leap. I was wondering, like, what was that like working with Scott Bakula? And you know,
I remember that. I remember doing the show, and it was a good role. And it was, in fact, the show I did, I'm positive of this, was voted one of the 10 best of their entire run, the Quantum Leap run. That show I was on was voted one of the, It was Quantum Leap. Yeah, I did a show where they were waiting to find out if they were going to have another season. So the set was a little, they were a little boisterous. They were a little anxious. They were waiting for the producer, the crew and the cast were waiting for the producer to announce whether they had another season. And meanwhile, we're trying to focus, you know, and do the job. But that's what I remember about it. So, and Dean Stockwell, I'm a fan of Dean Stockwell. Mm-hmm. Over the years, I've been a big fan of his. And I like working with him. I knew him before the show, but he's a fine actor, so it was good to be around the good actor, you know. That's all I remember about him.
Have you ever gone out, specifically had your agent reach out to a show because you're a fan of the show and just want to be a part of it? Has that ever happened?
Yeah, that happens. I call, like, I've been watching a show. I don't know if you guys know The Americans. Do you know the show?
Oh, yeah, on FX, yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to get a shot at doing something on that show. And I called the agent a couple weeks ago, and we found out who the casting director is. Yeah, I'd love to be a part of a show like that. The Americans I've been watching. Yeah, of course. I watch shows and I go, you know, who's casting this? And, you know, yeah. But now it's The Americans and I can't find another show. I loved that John Turturro show. John Turturro?
Yeah, John Turturro. HBO series.
I love that. I love that show. It's hard not to love it. What was the name of it?
The Night Of.
I love what they did with that.
If I'm not mistaken, I think that John Turturro's role that was originally going to be James Gandolfini, I believe.
That's right. Yeah. Jimmy produced it too. And Jimmy was going to play that role. And actually, they did. He did do it. They shot the whole show. And then the tragedy happened. And they had to reshoot the whole thing, and they reshot it with John Turturro. Jimmy did play that character.
Yeah. Oh,
wow. And I'd love to see that one, too, what he did with that. But the one show, he only did one show.
Right.
Jimmy.
Right.
And then,
So, all right. Well, Adam, do you have any other questions for him? We don't want to take up too much of your time. I know that you don't seem to do a lot of interviews, so we're really honored to have you on here and to have a chance to chat with you.
I enjoy it. When you get on with guys who know their stuff and do their homework, it's easy. Like, you guys have done your homework. You know movies I've been in. You look. So it makes it easy. But when you get talking to people who go, and tell me about what? You know, so what movies have you done? Or I know Sopranos. They always know Sopranos.
Sure.
Yeah.
And they know Short, but they know nothing else. And it's nice to talk to guys who know I've done a couple of other jobs.
Just a few.
Oh, just one or two, yeah. Yeah, I do, often I do things on the radio where I'll call in to different stations and they hire me to do characters or prank phone calls and stuff like that. And there's nothing more frustrating than you have to get up at 6 a.m. and call into some station in Cleveland. And then the DJ hasn't bothered to come up with a bit or premise. And he just asks, well, what did you just do in Tampa or something like that? So you have to basically, it's like they can't even be bothered to do any homework or whatever. And then you've got to come up with an idea on the fly for that. So I can imagine that's gotta be frustrating.
It's a drag. In fact, you know, when we did Michael's play, when I did Michael's play, Queen for a Day, we did Today's show, the morning Today's show.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
You saw that. Did no research. They did nothing. nothing. I mean, this is a big time show, national, everything. And they did nothing.
It was like a 3-minute interview with you,
me and Vinny Pastore.
And by the end of the 3 minutes, they were showing a clip of Family Feud and talking about Kathy Lee Gifford instead of you guys in your play. It was surreal.
I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it. I stopped it. I looked up and I said, hey, Kathy did has done well.
You
and
did.
Now let's talk about the play.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe what they were doing. It was like insane to me. It was insane. I'm watching Jeopardy. I mean,
it's really strange. What is it like when you have to do like those press junkets where you just have to sit in one hotel room and do it again and again and again? Like, is that the worst?
Well, you know, it depends on the guys. If
yeah.
they do their research, then it makes it easy. But when they don't, it feels like I'm doing an interview and trying to get a job.
Yeah.
You know, it feels like I'm being interviewed for a job, and that I stop those. I've been on phones with guys like, listen, guy, thank God bless us all. God bless America. I got it.
And
I get off, man.
I see that you did vinyl on HBO, which teamed you back up with Martin Scorsese,
yeah.
right?
Because
he produced that, and you guys both got your start with Mean Streets.
Marty put me on the show,
mm-hmm.
and I played Bobby Cannavale's dad,
uh-huh.
and if we had a second season, Marty said to me, second season, you're going to be around a lot. And I said, Marty, great, you know, and then bingo, you know, what happened?
And yeah.
HBO reneged and said, they didn't renege, but whatever their option was,
mm-hmm.
they pulled the plug. Yeah, but I thought I'd be working on vinyl right now as we speak.
Yeah. Did you have any...
showbiz, kids.
That's showbiz. Did you have any interaction with Mick Jagger on that project? Did you cross paths
no,
at all?
No, never even met him.
No.
His son was on the show. I met his son.
Okay.
Nice kid.
Yeah.
Nice kid, but between you and I... acting is a whole other thing, and mm-hmm. some people don't understand that there's a craft involved.
Yeah.
And you really should know something.
Yeah.
And the kid is a nice kid, and he's fine, but they gave him too much to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you followed the show, if you saw it, but he had a lot of heavy stuff to do. And he wasn't ready. I don't think he was ready as an actor at all.
Yeah.
Mick Jagger's son. They should have, anyway. That's that. I got a big mouth, don't I?
Quite all right.
Watch this.
We almost got a scoop. And now you have a film coming out next year called High and Outside about a mind.
No, let's forget about that. What happened was that High and Outside. No, forget it.
Okay.
What happened with High and Outside was a friend of mine who asked me to do him a favor
uh-huh.
and come. Well, actually, I teach over the years, and a student of mine had a film mm-hmm. for himself and asked me if I would do a day on it.
Uh-huh.
And I just saw, not the movie, I'm not talking about the movie, but I'm not, no, I don't even know why they keep saying I'm in there for a blink of the eye just to do the guy a favor and be in the movie.
Okay.
So I don't talk about it.
Okay.
I don't like what I did in it. I don't like what I did. I'm terrible. I don't want to talk about it.
Well, we can certainly.
I want to talk about this. I just did a movie in Lisbon last March
uh-huh.
with Michael Imperioli from The Sopranos.
Uh-huh.
Michael, you know Michael.
Christopher Moltisanti, of course.
Yeah, of course. And Michael's wonderful actor, great actor.
Mm-hmm.
And he asked me to come do this movie with him.
Mm-hmm.
And next month I'll know whether we're in the Berlin Film Festival or not.
Oh, okay.
And if we get in, I'm going. It's Michael. It's a great film for Michael. And it's sort of like a Casablanca meets Wizard of Oz.
Movie.
You know, one of those. It's so wild. It's a great film, and I like my role in it. I hope it's still there. The director, Bruno, Portuguese actor, musician, director, okay. wonderful guy,
wow.
a great, wonderful madman,
mm-hmm.
you know, one of those great madmen. And he's very happy right now, I'm hearing. So I'm excited about that.
That's
and
cool.
I did another movie. I don't know yet what it looks like, but I'm hearing it looks great. And I play a brain-damaged man who has an encounter with his son who It's an interesting little drama. I don't know what's going to be with that. But Michael's movie, I'm excited about. I think it could be a good movie.
Is the,
so waiting on two movies. Yeah.
The Brain Damage Man, is that Father or Papa I'm seeing here?
Yeah, Papa.
Yeah, Papa.
Papa, yeah.
And that,
yeah. Very challenging.
With Paul Sorvino again. And Vinny Pastore as well.
Great scene in that. And Vinny's in it too. Mm-hmm. And Paul and I have a great scene in it. It's a great scene. And Paul plays the brain damaged, but intensely brain damaged man, almost a kind of border on. It's a great scene, and Paul does great work in it. You know, Paul does, mm-hmm. And I play his friend, and it's a wonderful scene. And I'm throughout the movie, I'm Papa.
Okay.
But we'll see what happens.
Oh, wow. That movie has a hell of a cast. What a great cast. Michael Madsen.
No. Michael Madsen's in it. He does a good scene. I have a scene with him.
Misha
and
Barton.
Eric Roberts, who's a great actor, and he's in it. It's one of those, and that actress, what's her name? Jeez, crap, I'm bad shit.
Daryl Hannah, Misha Barton.
Daryl Hannah, right. Really good. Nice cast.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
That does look exciting.
Yeah.
Before we let you go, do you have any, you share any memories of working on Raymond? Were you actually in Italy? Did you get to go to Italy? Isn't that where your character...
Yeah, it was the only time a TV show, sitcom, CBS ever went on location, and we went to Italy.
Right.
I'm very lucky with that. Went to Rome, great time doing that. It's hard. I mean, Doris Roberts, sweet lady, may she rest in peace, and Peter Boyle, two great actors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they can... They had it down, but situation comedy is a whole other kind of theater, and that. And I was happy to do the show. I mean, it was number one comedy, but I think I didn't really. I felt very leaded on it. I always kept saying, "I feel like a piece of lead here." I mean, I'm not, and which could have worked.
Mm-hmm.
I had a good time. Let me shut my mouth.
Well, they didn't. Yeah.
Hey. Paid me more. They paid me so much money. I'm very happy about that.
Sure.
Great people. Paycheck was incredible.
Yeah, but your character. Your character was kind of limited. I mean, he was really there just to intimidate Brad Garrett throughout. That was kind of a running gag.
Yeah.
They didn't flesh you out too much. Yeah.
Yeah, and then, you know, it's right, exactly.
Yeah.
How many times can you just stare at a guy and, you know, I was boring myself. Once you bore yourself, you better get out of there.
Yeah. well, sir, you have been anything but boring for us. We
Absolutely,
are
yeah.
just so grateful to have had some time to spend with you. We're just such fans of your work and want to thank you for your time and just wish you nothing but continued success. Thank you so much for chatting with us.
Thank you. Good, guys. Okay, I'll speak to you soon.
Take care.
All right, take care.
All right.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.